Lacrosse Legends. Lacrosse Legends, a comprehensive look at America's greatest game, featuring legends past, present, and future. Today on Lacrosse Legends, correspondent Bernard Williams talks lacrosse with Syracuse University legends Keith Owens and Rodney Dumpson.
The years were 1988, 1989, and 1990. America was going through a presidential election. George H.W. Bush was elected as the 41st president of the United States. Meanwhile, America also had a war on drugs. U.S. President Ronald Reagan signed a bill providing the death penalty for murderous drug traffickers. The price of gasoline averaged 96 cents a gallon. The World Wide Web was introduced. Eddie Murphy was coming to America. Lethal Weapon 2 was blowing up. And Syracuse University was cementing his legacy as one of the nation's best collegiate lacrosse programs. Rodney Dumpson and Keith Owens played together at Syracuse. Owens graduated in 1988, Dumpson in 1990.
He scores! Rodney Dumpson cuts the margin to one again, 11-10. What a game! Rodney Dumpson, pretty much a guy who carries the water for the Gates boys, carries the water for the Gates boys, carries the water for the Gates boys.
Don't get too close because your mic is shot.
Mr. Rodney Dumpson, one of the best lacrosse players to ever come out of Fort Washington, Long Island. Dumpson possessed both speed and a quick rifle shot, helping take Syracuse lacrosse program to new heights. Dumpson's game-winning goal secured the victory for Syracuse Orangemen in the 1989 championship game for John.
Takes the bad pass, makes one move, and fires the shot for his second goal, believe, of the day. Second goal for Dumpson.
And 16th goal of the season.
And Paul Gate, I think, is 4-2 on the day.
Well, now, Don Zimmerman's Johns Hopkins Blue Jays are under the gun.
Well, it all started way back when I was young. I played lacrosse because in my town, lacrosse was the big thing in the spring. Growing up in Long Island, it was all about lacrosse. I started playing, I guess, in sixth grade, fifth grade. I enjoyed it. It was different because all the kids in the neighborhood played basketball. One of my best friends, my brother, Keith Owens, him and his brother were one of the few kids from our neighborhood that actually played lacrosse.
I started to play lacrosse in 73 or 74 at PYA. The reason that I started to play was because I guess my childhood sports idol was my brother Billy. So I started around 8 years old. I used to go down there and watch those guys play. You know, I liked the sport. Everything was good with lacrosse. The only thing that I didn't like when we first started was that I had a wooden stick and everybody else had plastic sticks. We couldn't afford them. No cleats.
I soon lost interest. Back then, there weren't too many. Like you said, there was only a few guys playing. Basketball was like the sport, as it is in every neighborhood like mine.
Then when I went to 10th grade, I was on varsity. So I played on the varsity 3 years, graduated in 1983, all conference. 22 goals, 54 assists, something like that.
I started playing again in 10th grade. I didn't really get a chance to experience that middle tier kind of lacrosse thing where you really learn the game. It was more about athleticism when you're young, and then you learn the mental part of it as you grow, like every other sport. It tumbled quickly. I felt that I was a better athlete than a lot of guys that were playing in front of me, and you know, it just upset me that I wasn't getting the playing time I thought I should be getting. So I quit. I remember the coach told me, he brought me in the room and he said, gave me the whole spiel about, oh, you should stay with it, trust me, perseverance, this, that. All of the stuff that we get. I guess it worked out though, because then I wound up coming back to the sport. I played JV in 10th grade, varsity in 11th grade, 11th and 12th. I enjoyed it, but it wasn't until college that I really enjoyed it, because depending on where and who you are in this game, there's a lot of politics involved. And the best player doesn't always play. I fell victim to that little curb thing there. It worked out. I mean, if you look at the history and you look at how it all ended up, it worked out pretty good for me. But the sport, it's a great sport, but there are a lot of things about it that don't sit well in my stomach.
next on Lacrosse Legends. You're watching Lacrosse Legends.
So here's where it gets interesting. I never started in my high school. And ironically enough, I wind up starting on the number one team in the nation. A few years later, you do the math. How I got to Syracuse was the most interesting thing of all. In Long Island, you have summer leagues. All of the guys from, you know, the Johns Hopkins, the North Carolinas, the Virginias, and all of the big-time Division I schools, the majority of them were from Long Island. So they would come home after they would graduate or play on Team USA, and it was like one big, huge lacrosse factory. I wound up playing lacrosse in the summer of 84. I excelled. There were a few guys that I remember vividly, the Brendan Schnecks of the world, the Vinny Sombrados. They were already established. They were like MVPs of Team USA and all of that stuff. They kind of took to me a bit. They were like, listen, no one here can keep up with you as far as, you know, running. The six skills were a little suspect. I wound up going to Farmingdale first. I followed my friend, my brother, Keith Owens there.
When I got to Farmingdale, Fred Acey was my coach. As soon as I got there, we were practicing, and I thought, oh my God, I'm never going to be able to do this because, you know, the guys are out there throwing behind their back, beating around. And by the third day, I was like, oh, there's no problem. I was starting. And when they called the first midfield, I was on it.
I never registered. The whole idea of it was like I was on my own. I didn't understand college and how to go about, you know, getting in and the paperwork and all that. So that year of 84, I didn't go to college.
At Farmingdale, I made first team All-American. And then from there, I was going to say, why go to Farmingdale and end up paying, you know, grand a year? And when I can go to Nassau and go for free. So I transferred and went to Nassau.
He said to me, listen, I'm going to go to Nassau. He transferred from Farmingdale. Why don't you come to college? Because I had worked that year. And I said, all right, why not? I'll give it a shot. I was already, you know, I like lacrosse. And Richie Speckman, to his credit, was a really nice guy. And assistant coach George, they welcomed me. I met a bunch of guys that I played against from Hempstead and Uniondale and Bethpage and all that. And all these guys were transferring out of Nassau, going to these big Division I schools. I said, all right, you know what? I'll play lacrosse. So I went on to play. I never played at Nassau. I played, I think, fall ball, and I had a chip on my shoulders because I felt that I was good, and I just didn't feel that I got the proper, like, attention that I deserved. I
played for Richie Speckman. I had the same type of feelings. I was like, you know, these guys are really good, you know? What's going to go on? But by the third practice, once again, I was starting. At Nassau, I ended up making first team All-American again.
And I remember Richie Speckman said to me, to this day, I'll never forget it. He's like, I don't give a bleep, bleep, bleep how good you think you are. You're going to play the way I want you to play.
Get out of yourself and get into team. You know, for some of them, you know, I'm better than you and I can do it my way. And get them to all play the same way and like playing together as a team as opposed to individually. You know, play the game and play it this way. You know, that was just my way of coaching, and, you know, it took some kids a little longer to believe in it. And, you know, when you have success, then they say, I guess that is the way we should do it.
He was right. I was wrong, but I also knew Syracuse was in the cards there.
We had a friend named Cliff Bendelson, who was at Syracuse, who was telling Roy Simmons about Rodney and I.
Because at that point, I had heard from the Syracuse coach, and I didn't know where it was going to lead, but I just... At that point, you hear from a school like that, you're just like, I'm going. That was my mindset.
They told me all I needed to do was get a certain GPA, which I did. And from there, you know, it ended up at Syracuse.
I think I quit fall ball. Richie wanted me to do something, and I wasn't really trying to do it. So we didn't see eye to eye. Now, looking back, I'm kind of glad I didn't, because I wound up not losing the eligibility to go to Syracuse. Keith went on to become an All-American again. At Nassau Community College. So now he's a two-time All-American, and we're off to Syracuse. So I redshirt the first year. Keith goes ahead. He's on the team.
The whole family in the crowd. And always the man with the master plan to make a nigga with Jimmy a gentleman. This thing what I'm saying until you've been instructed. Ain't sleeping to eat. You see something might rush it. It don't take time for me to blow your mind. It take a second to wreck it because you're dumb and blonde. So just lounge. But you were in Mr. Keith Owens, known to have had one of the fastest and hardest shots on Long Island. In 1988, Owens was an integral part of Syracuse's run to the National Title. I'm drawing more like a 44 Magnum. MC Free, stop looking, listen, and try to imagine. It's traveling the speed of light, but everything's motion is frightening. I was on the same midfield with Gary and Paul Gate.
I played more in the playoffs that year than I did the whole year. And that was kind of funny to me. You know, if you're not able to play during the course of the year, why are you getting a lot of minutes during the playoffs? The next year when I came back, the midfields were supposed to be Gate and Owens, but the coach told me that we're going to even out the lines and we're going to put you on the second midfield, which didn't really make any sense to me. You figure you put your best players out on the field. But I took a class in Syracuse, and the teacher was a guy by the name of Roland Grimes, and he said there's a thing that they do which is called tracking. As far as minorities, they're only going to put a certain amount on the field at a time unless they need to win the game. So I guess I figured, I ended up under the track. And that year, we won the national championship in 1988. And that was, the end of my lacrosse career there.
His whole career formed mine because he went through all the stuff, the trials and tribulations that I didn't, because he did it first and I saw what to do and more so what not to do, you know? And when I went up there, I'll be honest with you, it was culture shock. All of these kids from Yorktown, West Genesee, I had never seen that. I had never seen players like that. And of course, we were all recruited together in the dome with Gary and Paul Gate, ironically enough. So here we all are in the Carrier Dome. And, I don't have to say any more about those two. We all know who they are and what they did for the game. And the rest is pretty much history. I mean, it was a beautiful thing.
Next on Lacrosse Legends. You're watching Lacrosse Legends.
Oh! Gets it to Maracek. Couple of behind-the-back passes, and Rodney Dumpson adds goal number 19.
We asked them both, how would they fare in today's game?
I think I would do the same. Speed kills. There wasn't that many people that were going to run with me, and I had my stick was good. So, and now the way they play the game with these deep pockets, it would be a little bit easier.
I agree with Keith. The shifts are different. Middies don't play defense anymore. So all you got to do is go out there and sprint and get off the field. Your endurance doesn't have to be like what it once was. So, I mean, the players are bigger and stronger, but we would be as well. We'd be, our regiment would be different as far as working out and doing all that stuff.
Why'd you knock me down? That's a shrugging match.
Dumpson spoke on how the game has changed.
As far as the pro game, it's hard to say because the pro game to me, you can't hit anymore. So all of that dipsy doodle and the behind the back and all of that, it looks good, it sells, but you know as well as I do that you do that once or twice a game, The next time you come across that crease, defenseman, is a problem.
On the move is Goldstein. They knocked the ball away from him. He was crunched after that takeaway. See the tail end of the play.
Got a lot of blood on that face. He got a cut right on the nose.
His job is to actually, they say make him pay.
Goldstein paid after that ball was knocked away. We've got an injured Cornell player down.
The game itself caters to selling the sport versus the raw lacrosse of it all, like how it was gritty and you got hit and you had to either suck it up or get on the sideline, whereas now it's an unsportsmanlike to hit a guy or slashes. And again, you can't even get the ball out of the stick without basically slashing a person. So it leans more towards scoring. And the players understand that.
He's on the field. That's the extra official you may see walking along. Owen shoots high, and he scores. To the wide side, the high side, Keith Owens.
We ask, what can make the game of lacrosse better?
Okay, that's a good question, and I think I have a good answer. Some may disagree, but I think, like in hockey, there ought to be a double assist.
An assist. An assist is a play made by a player to a teammate who then scores a goal without having to evade excessive defensive pressure other than the goalkeeper. Only one assist per goal may be recorded in lacrosse. Other sports such as hockey, basketball, and soccer give up 2 assists per score. These sports recognize the importance toward whoever initiated the play that led to a goal. Although critics say the second assist is a gift rather than a statistic. If it weren't for this stat, you wouldn't have a Wayne Gretzky, Dennis Rodman, or Landon Donovan.
If you know the game, let's say you come down. I'm playing D. I'm a D midi. Oh, I'm a midfielder, but I happen to get caught on the defensive end.
Right.
I make a great defensive play. I go down. I understand the game. It's all about hit the point.
Right.
I hit the point. And if you know the game, you know the second pass is the guy that scores the goal.
Right.
So I created the hole. I created the havoc. I stole the ball. I go down. I draw the man. I throw it to the point. He, in turn, his man comes to cover him. The slide comes. He dumps it down to the attackman. Next thing you know, it's a point-blank shot.
Right.
So guess what? I got nothing. I create, you know,
right,
Pat McCabe, Dave Petromala did it all their whole careers. I think that that's one point that should definitely be looked at in lacrosse like it is in hockey, because, you know, lacrosse being an All-American and all that stuff, a lot of it's predicated on, especially offensive, is scoring. Who's got the most goals? Who's got the most assists? And if you are a facilitator, you may not get that look. Even though you created a lot of it,
right,
you just don't really, you know, you're not being rewarded for it.
Right.
And you're working just as hard, if not harder. You created that goal,
right,
that fast break.
You created the situation.
Exactly.
Maybe change the sticks and not let them squeeze the head as much, and the pockets are very deep. On a hard check, the ball doesn't even come out of the stick. And I would also change the way that they do the face-off, because these guys clamp down on the ball, and the ball gets stuck in between the head, they pick it up, and they're running with it instead of, you know, clamping it down and getting it out or scooping it up. They're clamping down on the ball, and it's stuck on the backside of the head. You know, I think that kills the face-off.
We promise these gentlemen that lacrosse legends will personally take their concerns to U.S. lacrosse.
A quick turn to the attackman, and here's Rodney Dumpson. This guy, underrated, but very rarely outplays. Outstanding midfielder. He's got around the defenseman there, Bresci. The Dumpson scores.
Here's Owens, 20 yards from the cage, shooting and scoring.
Spoke about what was their competitive edge.
Coming from the neighborhood that we came from, there was nothing but competition there. Every day, no matter what sport you play, you're gonna compete. You can't coach speed. There's a lot of guys who are out there running 4.8s, 4.9s, and when they're trying to keep up, how are they gonna keep up running a 4.5 or less?
Playing basketball was my measuring stick. So when I got to lacrosse, it was a lot easier because I was faster. It all starts on line drills.
Right.
When you have to do one-on-one drills,
right,
and you start counting, you look at the guys and you say, okay, oh, I got to go against him.
Right.
And you can actually see the guys that all of a sudden have to tie their shoes. So you know what that means. That
Absolutely.
Means they don't want to go one-on-one against you.
Right, exactly.
You can see it in the helmet. You can
right.
see it. And
body language.
Not to say that there were a lot of guys like that, because Syracuse was tough. I mean, you had the best of the best. But you knew, okay, at least I got you mentally right now.
Right.
And if I got you mentally, you know I got you physically.
Right.
So that was where the edge came from.
Gary and Paul on the exchange. Paul goes to the right hand. And it is safe, but it comes out and Dumpson puts it back. And it is 5-1 Syracuse.
He asked them about things they learned or taken from the game of lacrosse.
You learn life lessons. You're not going to win them all. Once you get knocked down, you pick yourself up, you dust yourself off, and you move forward. Adjusting to certain situations on the team, being at one time the only person of color, that's a big adjustment. But you learn how to deal with that. It gave me a different perspective on life. I got a lot from the sport of lacrosse. You know, I met a lot of interesting people and a lot of lifelong friends. It gave me some opportunities that I may not have had.
As Keith said, lifelong friends. I got friends right now to this day that I play golf with every time they come to New York, well, come downstate, Greg Burns, Matt Palum, so forth, so on. I mean, the whole team. That unit was special. You know, when you win like that, you see things that you normally wouldn't see, you see. You know,
right.
The road trips, I mean, you just become one unit. I just wish that I had more guidance. I didn't know what you know, what I was in for when I went up there.
Right.
I guess everybody would say that, though. Keith experienced a lot more stuff than I did, so by the time I got there, he had paved the way.
Right.
I give all the credit to him. I mean, if it wasn't for him, I probably wouldn't have succeeded at Syracuse.
Would you recommend today's youth to play lacrosse? Most definitely. If a person is athletic and they pick the sport up at a young age, they'll do well. It's one of those sports that if you're athletic enough and you play it long enough, you're probably going to get a scholarship, and you'll be able to go to the Syracuse, the Dukes, North Carolina, Colorado, and Michigan State, and Arizona. It'll change some people's lives, taking places that they may have never went before.
I was just talking to a friend of mine the other day about this, and his kid is one of the top lacrosse players in the nation, and he's also one of the top football players. Now, I'd be lying if I didn't tell you I told him to go take football.
Right.
Get that four-year full ride where you don't have to take out any loans, grants, any of that stuff.
Right.
And then turn around and walk on the lacrosse team.
Right.
If you're good enough, they'll find you.
Right.
So, yeah, I would say go ahead, get that education. Because at the end of the day, that's what it's really all about anyway.
Absolutely.
Nobody's retiring millionaires from playing lacrosse.
Right.
And it's an opportunity of a lifetime. Down at the Syracuse Duke game, I forget what year it was, whatever. It was the national championship game. And we were walking up the stairs at the Lincoln Financial, that's the stadium, right? And he says, "Hey, Rodney, how you doing? Dumpson, hey, you know this, that." He goes, "Boy, I haven't seen you in forever." He goes, "Boy, you guys were something else, yada, 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 yada." Right? Then he says to me, "You know, you got any kids?" I said, "Yeah, I got a little girl." And he goes, "Oh, wow, that's good. Does she play lacrosse?" I go, "No, no." He goes, "Oh, man, you got to get her to play lacrosse. If she's got any, if she gets any of your ability, oh, God, it'll be perfect. She can run the ball up the field and give it to my daughter."
Wow.
Did he say that?
Mm-hmm.
Swear he said that to me.
Wow.
And I played it off like, yeah, ha, ha, ha. But at the time, we you know, that look we gave each other like, here we go again.
Right.
You know,
wow.
Like.
Never changed. Same old, same.
I couldn't believe it.
Wow.
The sad part about it is, it's not that he said it. It's that he didn't think he said anything wrong.
Right. Like it was natural. Right.
True story.
This is Bernard Williams for Lacrosse Legends.
My opinion, honestly, one of the real reasons this sport hasn't excelled is because the real athlete, A, goes to football, basketball, all that other kind of stuff, because at the end of the day, he's discouraged before he's allowed to flourish. What I mean by that is, if I'm faster, bigger, stronger than you, right off the bat, you put me on defense. Now, there's no glory in defense. Don't get me wrong. I'm saying, you know how it is. Guys, you know, you can make All-American being a defenseman, but when you're young, you know how it is.
Right.
When you make a team, it's, okay, we're going to make a team. Everybody run, you do your run. The fast guys go over here, and the slower guys go over there. That's the defense, and that's the offense. It's real simple. Now, if I'm fast, and you move me from this line and put me over here, I'm at a double whammy, like, wow, where do I fit in? Why am I being moved from here to here? And that's when we get discouraged and we don't want to play the game. And I know you got friends that played the game, picked it up, could have played, but just decided, man, I'm not going to sit on this bench. I'm not going to, you know, and that's what happens. And a good friend, Vinny Sabato, we were talking about this, and he said the kids like Rob Moore, like his son, and the kids, like all these NFL guys, when their kids start playing the sport, like Junior Seau's son,
right.
You know, when you start getting
right.
Those guys involved, like freak athletes, once they start getting involved,
right.
Then the game will really evolve.
Right.
But if you start using them sparingly and put them on the defensive end, then they get discouraged and they don't want to play. It's really that simple.
And cut.
And that's a fact what I just said.
Then I start slapping and smacking you on a roll. Then I'll be starts chopping and capping. No time to lounge. I'm packing a strap. And at my point of attack, I soar at you like an eagle. I'm the sheriff, and biting is illegal. So next time in town, I highly recommend this. You got to chill because I'm strictly business. Hey, yo, you double man, let them know what time it is. Yeah, I'm strictly business. You know what I'm saying? PMD is in full effect.